Oh, then, gentlemen, you're hungry.
Just getting airborne and then nipping round the end of the bushes. Yeah, this is one of the things the Storch is absolutely famous for. It's just one of those really, really weird aeroplanes. Now, first of all, look at the length of the undercarriage now. Now it's off the ground. Those OVOs must have nearly trebled in length. It's a big, soft, spongy undercarriage. It means you can get it down in very short, unprepared strips. Slacks all the way along the leading edge, as you can see. Not only slacks on the trailing edge, but the edge or the boot as well. They're all cutting flat and flat. It means it can fly incredibly slowly. Designed at Fieseler by Reinhold Muse. The technical director, Eric Backup. Now, Eric Backup was fascinated now. He went on to design a really weird aeroplane, including the Backup Meta, a disposable throwaway rocket propelled interceptor. Well, at Fieseler, designed this, three seats. Liaison, Army Corporation, and Medical Evacuation Aeroplane. Again, stretchers can be fitted in the rear fuselage in place of the rear seat. First flew in 1936, introduced into service with the German Army and the Luftwaffe Army Corporation Squadron. In 1937, although we developed aircraft like the Lysander to fulfil the Army Corporation role, and later on we have things like the Piper Cub and the Oster series, arguably this has to be the best aeroplane that was designed for that role. A number of captured examples, for instance, were used in the Western Desert and Italy. I have just heard, ladies and gentlemen, that Gene DeMarco and Stu Goldsmith are still intending to fly the pair of BU-2s. So, for those of you who are thinking of losing, very shortly on the carpet, you'll see something that has not occurred in the size of the United Kingdom. Since my reckoning, April the 22nd, 1913. I think it's worth saying. This particular aeroplane, owned by the magnificent Peter Holloway. It's the only description for him. That's because he's bigger than me and he's standing very close. Powered by the original French built aeroplane under license. Powered with the radio. Now there's no theories with the original engine. Now this is one of them. The 240 horsepower Argus AS10 air-cooled inverted V8 for a distinctive sound. Gives the aircraft a maximum speed of 109 miles an hour, but hang on a minute. Yeah, I'll just talk to Pete Holloway. He's put it down here to have a little chat with him about this. And possibly just put me in the head for that magnificent comment earlier. Quite like to. So Pete, we were talking about a stall. What do you do?
Well, actually, it's an aircraft that doesn't stall. If you pull the stick all the way back, the aircraft will come down in a very high nose attitude, and the undercarriage, 9 times out of 10, will absorb the landing shock, and you'll walk away from it unscathed. It actually doesn't stall, but with power on, it doesn't actually stall either in the conventional sense. You would really have to pull it up into the beginning of an aerobatic maneuver, and then of course gravity will take over. So actually it's an aircraft that doesn't stall because of the full span leading edge slots and the huge barn door flaps and drooping ailerons. It's a mad thing.
A mad thing. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen, from a man who owns it. Some remarkable stories about this aeroplane from the war. Hannah Reich flew Absolutely flat turn. Yeah, there you go. There's the power of that rudder. No roll at all. Absolutely flat turn. Huge rudder surface on the back of the aeroplane. And it's that kind of maneuverability, particularly on the battlefield, is invaluable for senior officers, generals and stuff. Irving Rommel had one of these machines to use in the Western Desert. I put the band over the battlefield area. And of course, any self-respecting fighter pilot would go, oh, I'll have that easy. And then suddenly find that he couldn't actually draw a bead on it. Because it was travelling far too slowly. Hannah Reich, famous German test pilot, actually got to interview her at the IS Museum before she died. Very strange lady. Here we go, no die attitude. And look at this, it's a wind, almost coming through. Oh, it's rough faster than that. That's crazy. See quite clearly there, the ailerons were drooping with the flaps. Oh, still are, actually. That is something else. Well, as I was saying, Hannah Reich actually landed one of these on Unterdenlinden, which is the famous road that runs through the middle of Berlin. While the city was under attack by the Russian army, there was shell fire going off all over the place. To get the last orders out of Hitler's bunker, she stayed with the aircraft while the general went inside to get his orders. And he came back and they took off again. Right out the middle of the city while it was under attack. Quite astounding. Benito Mussolini, obviously, rescued from his castle in the mountains. There you see Helding, one of these aircraft, he was glider-borne troops were sent in to assault the guard guarding him. And then one of these aircraft was landed in a very short mountain strip to fly him out again. As I said, whenever one was captured intact, it tended to be pressed into service by the Allies, the best of the breed. Very simply. Incredibly useful, incredibly acceptable, I think. Very short takeoff, only 60 yards, very short landing, only 120. It really is quite astounding, isn't it? It's not so much flying as sort of, I don't know, puttering about. Oh, here you go. How short can he stop it in? Zero wind, what was that, 100 metres? If that. We've got Mum and the Fieseler Storch, ladies and gentlemen. Damn big machine. Oh, well, there he's off again. And the comment that just came round the corner from the owner saying, it's just too much fun. I can believe it. I can absolutely believe it. Ladies and gentlemen, but Peter Marco and Steve Goldstein are actually strapped in to the BBC. them is. The one's being prop-swung at the moment. Yeah, they're both running. Well, this is going to be a fabulous way to end the evening. Able to carry a variety of light machine guns in the rear cockpit for self-defence. Often fired through mounts in the upper windows of the Storch. And interestingly, what is recorded as being the last air-to-air engagement of the Second World War in Europe happened between one of these aircraft and, would you believe, an Obstert AOP up there on the air tour. It's still not quite clear if it's working, is it true? Well, I don't know. They're on the air tour, say that the Storch was forced away from the area that it was supposed to be reconnoitering, therefore they won. And the Storch said that the Oster was last seen descending in a way with smoke coming from its engine, so they won. But some of the early Osters had smoke coming from their engine even when they were healthy, so very difficult to tell since they both got back to their respective bases. Oh, that is quite a machine, isn't it? Speed landing this time.
Whoa. See how the undercarriage compresses.
Okay, I was even shorter than the first one. Good lord. Well, where's the signal gone? A little bit of blue, no rain, and no wind either. Things are looking... I just can't believe he's going. I think it's okay. And some of my catches in. And put the Holloway through the door. But about to take place is a sight you will want to see in the sky over England. By my reckoning, and I'll check this fairly carefully, since the 22nd of April, 1919.